ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Kisses taste like candy jam. You can see what a fool I am when your lips meet mine. Bim, bam. Baby, let me have some fun.
I wanted to be the last one in Chester as an individual pharmacist, and I was. When I started, this is hard to believe, there were 23 pharmacies. 23. When I left there, there was one. Me. When I opened the store, it was 1965. I had been working for one pharmacist for 7 years. I said to my father, I said, Dad, I would appreciate if you could give me some money to open up my own pharmacy. I'm ready. And he said, you sure you're going to be able to work all them hours? And I said, well, I am ready. I'm going to do it. I was 27 years old. I worked 9 in the morning till 10 at night. All pharmacies stayed open until 10 at night. There were no chain drugstores. There was no thrift, there was no Rite Aid, there was no CVS and no Walgreens. It was all little pharmacies competing against each other. My job was to beat out the other pharmacies. I don't know how I did it now. I don't know how I did it, but it's true. It was work constantly. A guy that was in my wedding, an usher, approached me and said, I would like to buy your business. And I says, really, I'm not for sale. I don't want to work for anybody anymore. He said, well, if you don't sell me your business, I'm going to buy the whole strip shopping center. And when your lease runs out, you're done. I was up against it. I asked my father, I said, shall I sell to him and open up somewhere else, or should I stick it out and fight him out? He said, you should fight him out. So what he did was he opened up a drugstore right next door to me. Not across the street and not down the street, right next door. We battled it out for 9 years. There was two ways I did it. Number one, I was extra nice to every customer. Went out of my way to do anything I could for them. And I had a decent personality to begin with, so I really went out of my way for everybody. And the other thing is I competed on price. I would beat his price on every possible thing. Even if I lost money, I would beat his price. It killed the other two pharmacies. They couldn't compete. They were ultra professional, had the white coat, and wanted to stick by their price, and it didn't work. Our prices made the difference. So my brother was looking around for a location for me, so he found a store on 21st Street, which was about 4 blocks away, much smaller than my original store. And I said, no, I don't know if this can do all the business we wanted to. It's only 1,000 square feet. He said, well, it's better than nothing for a while. And then if you find something bigger, you can go into it. Well, believe it or not, that location with 1,000 square feet lasted 30 years. My wife told Steve in the 70s, Steve, your father's getting sick. He's working all the hours and he can't take it much. He's getting older now. It would be good if you went to pharmacy school, because this other fellow who was competing with me wouldn't let up. So I needed a real help. And sure enough, he went to pharmacy school 5 years, graduated in 1983, and came to work right away for me, and did a great job. did a great job.
It always seemed like I was going to be the one that went into pharmacy and kind of took over the store to alleviate some stress for my father.
He was really, really terrific, yeah. And his personality was just terrific.
Well, I'll never forget my first day on the job after 5 years of pharmacy school when I got behind the typewriter. And I was nervous, I mean, you know. And my father was there next to me and he said, I just want you to remember one thing, speed first, then accuracy. So naturally I laughed because, you know, everything you learn in pharmacy school is about safety, not speed. But, you know, it was kind of funny, but he was kind of alluding to the fact, you know, try to keep the people moving, because back then, you know, it was customer service was critical, because patients could go whatever they want. They all paid for their medication, and we would like to get people in and out of the pharmacy as quick as possible. I worked and took it very seriously, worked really hard. And you know, our whole family revolved around the pharmacy, and you know, would be talking to my father every day, and we were able to remain in business and be successful, one patient at a time. So, and that's still our basically the way we think about it today. When it came to adding new people to the business, I would look for people that care. They needed to care about other people, and they needed to be hard workers, because it's a tough job. They have to be committed to accuracy. There is no, the margin for error in pharmacy is zero, and that's what you need to come to work with every day, because on any given day you can make a mistake that could end someone's life. So I took that very seriously, and so they had to take it very seriously.
The biggest mistake I made in my life as far as business was hiring the wrong people. And Steve had a knack for hiring the right people. It seems like whatever he does, it turns out good. Whenever he starts a business, it seems to work out. He just happens to hire the right people to do the job. He comes up with an idea, and then he hires the right people to run it.
We chose to specialize in compounding starting in 1993 on a part-time basis, and then we've really now gone to a full-time basis with dedicated space starting in about 2008. So now we have six people dedicated to the compounding lab that are all full-time, and that is our mainstay of one part of our business. It's only been within the last 5 years we've really ramped it up with all the regulations that they've had in the industry. Once we moved from the old smaller store into the new space, and then acquired the store next to us to make a premier compounding lab, that's when our services have really taken off.
Well, I started Steve's vision of wanting to grow a respiratory business around the clinical management of patients, providing high quality in-home respiratory care. He brought me on as a respiratory therapist to design and develop COPD and asthma management programs that we could then turn and promote and sell to the pulmonologists and case managers and primary care physicians in the area. And that's what we started doing. And obviously, as we grew that business landscape of the respiratory business was changing, we saw that there were opportunities in other business lines, going out and doing our sales presentations to our referral sources and them asking questions about wound care and disposable supplies, we knew that we could take the model that was successful in the respiratory world and carry it over into the disposable business.
I was amazed. I was absolutely amazed. I couldn't believe the business he's doing down there, because I never dealt in anything like that. I dealt in pills and liquids. And when I saw bandages and catheters and all these different things, I was just amazed.
There's not one day in the last 33 years where I didn't think, where I ever thought we were secure and couldn't go out of business at any time. It was never anything like, wow, we've gotten to this point, we're successful, and we're going to sell this business. Never. We were fighting for our life the majority of the time, and up until today, still fighting. We overcame incredible odds to succeed like we did. Sometimes I called it for the football fans out there that might understand this, I used to call it the miracle at the Meadowbrook, because we're in the Meadowbrook Shopping Center. And I'm kind of comparing it to, there was the miracle in the Meadowlands with the Eagles. But it was kind of like nobody even knew we were really there. We grew the company to be on a run rate of $450 million this year. And truly, I don't think many people knew we were there. We were in a 3,000 square foot facility. My grandfather was a big force in my life. He was a really hard worker. It's all he talked about was work. And I worked for him some of the summers selling newspapers. He was a newspaper. He had a newspaper distributorship. He was a boxer in his 20s. And if people said, I heard you were a boxer, he would say, yeah, I box oranges. But a couple things that he said to me over the years that maybe I didn't understand at the time. I used to ask him if he worked hard, and he would say, no, I don't work hard, I work often. And later on, you start to think about these things, and it makes a lot of sense. Working hard to him meant digging ditches and so forth, whereas, and just like my profession, it's more working often.
The determination and the commitment to success, whether it's the CEO, you know, taking the trash out or painting the basement, both of things which Steve has done. And done very proudly, and shown us that's the way a company is successful.
When you really get to know people, you're able to help them in numerous ways. And so I got to know really everyone. Back in those days, everyone had their choice of their pharmacy. And so you would keep patients for year after year and watch their children grow up. So I just, my vision at that point was to just take care of patients and to try to continue to grow the business.
It's definitely, I think it's been our philosophy since the beginning. I mean, treating everybody as you know, as you would want to be treated.
Improving the quality of life for everybody. That was Steve, that's Steve's philosophy, I believe. And we do that here. It's take care of one patient at a time, like the only patient that you have is the one on the phone, and just do everything you can to help that one patient. And if it is just the helping one patient each day, just makes this all worthwhile.
So it was just like that connection with the patients that I just had this like light bulb moment. I was like, this is why my dad, Steve, does, you know, created this business and, you know, hired these people and has such a great team.
Growing up, my idol was Roberto Clemente, as he was for so many other people at that time. he was a true hero. And I, as a kid, I was able to really connect with the one thing that he would say, and I'm probably paraphrasing it, but he said that if someone asks for your help and you don't help them, you are wasting your time on this earth. For a person of 10 or 11, 12 years old, I always remembered that.
He's generous with his employees. He's generous with, I could name like 10 different charities that, you know, he has an interest in and continues and has continued to, you know, provide financial support. I mean, he built a gym. He's just done, you know, so many things. I would say he's probably one of the most generous people that I've ever worked for.
And he's sincerely generous. You know, he's not one doing it for any kudos or for people to like him better. It's just his way. And, you know, and he believes in sharing. And sharing with the teams and the kids, the sports, you know, not just sports. The things that he loves, he really gets involved in them. And that's like faith without works is dead faith. He's faithful and he works his faith.
I don't remember a day at DNA without Steve, because Steve seems like he has been here since the beginning, because when he came in the first day, he came in like gangbusters. One of the kids said, "Who are you?" And he said, "I'm Steve." And that's what he's been here to us. He's just been our Steve. And so he came about 2 or 3 years after our school began, just to come, you know, Steve, to see the school, because it had a gym attached to it and he had memories of Chester and that gym, and he wanted to come in and see it. And I think he fell in love with the kids. And Steve said that day he was going to support Drexel Newman Academy. A lot of people say that, but he came back the next day. And he keeps coming back and coming back and coming back. And he doesn't come back himself. He brings with him his family, his wonderful family, and the people he works with, who he also includes his family at Burman. So when did it begin with Steve? It began when he walked in the door, but it began with Burmans years ago here in the city of Chester. And Steve remembers where he came from, and he comes back.
Danny Murtaugh was the pirate manager, and he also lived in our neighborhood. So I just always connected with him, and when I had an opportunity, I noticed there's nothing in the city of Chester with his name on it. I had this idea of refurbishing a gym at Drexel Newman Academy and naming it after Danny Murtaugh Gymnasium, which we raised money and we were able to do. We got a new scoreboard with his picture on it. We redid the entire floor. It was a great event, and it was for a good cause, because I don't think that gym had been touched for the last 30 or 40 years. So trying to give back to the city of Chester.
I just think that kind of goodness, it makes me happy too. When you meet his family, and they're such thoroughly good people. So it gives me great hope for what's going to come for Max and Jakey when I meet Heidi. And she has that same spirit as Steve has. It gives you hope for the future, because you know that you have other people who are joining you on this mission, and they don't even know the kids, and yet they still are so supportive here of Chester.
Thank you, ma'am.
This is Anthony's Wire. I wanted to start by first saying congratulations to both Harvey and Steve for 50 incredible years in pharmacy and surviving as an independent all along. As I come from a long history of family independent pharmacies, it's been a pleasure to work here and amazing to see you guys succeed for this long. And the road ahead, is hard as it may be, you guys always seem to find a way through.
Congratulations, Harvey and Steve, for 50 exciting years. I'm proud and honored to be a part of your journey and looking forward to the next 50 years.
I want to say congratulations to Steve and Mr. Burman. I just want to say congratulations to Steve and Harvey, and I can't wait to see what you have in store for the next 50 years.
Congratulations, Steve.
So just congratulations to you both, Steve and Harvey, and best of luck to you in the future.
Congratulations, Steve, and all your hard work.
Congratulations. I remember walking into the pharmacy that was located in Chester when I was a child. My parents used it, and my family still does.
I would like to personally thank Mr. Burman for the opportunity. He's opened the doors for a lot of us, and I'm sure I'm not only speaking for myself, but I can speak for everybody in the office. He's opened the door for pretty much opportunity.
You guys are going to say something, right?
Yeah.
Eventually. Okay.
So, congratulations on 50 years.
Congratulations, Steve. Known you since 1978 and really proud of everything you've done.
Congratulations, Steve, Mr. Burman, on 50 years of Burmans, from the new employees, the old employees, the young employees. Congratulations, and we hope the best for you in the future.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Harvey and Steve.
Congrats, Burmans, on 50 years.
Congratulations, Steve and Harvey.
Stephen Harvey, I want to say congratulations on 50 years of service to the community. Harvey, your philosophy of hard work, dedication, has left a legacy to your family, friends, coworkers that is unmatched. We have people coming into Burman's all the time, asking about you and the store in Chester and reminiscing about all the memories that they have there. I consider this to be a real tribute to the Burman's family. Steve. My hero of the underdog. I remember 13 years ago when you took a chance on an underdog, me. 12 years as a stay-at-home mom, and I was looking to get back into the workforce. I have learned so much from you. You are the master of not only looking at data, but analyzing and spotting trends that have made these companies so successful. Your belief that everyone has something to offer and your willingness to give a person a chance to be successful is something to be admired. And finally, because I'm only allowed to talk so long, your use of parables, all right, is up there with the best of them. From the lessons of Roberto Clemente and the legend of Danny Murtaugh and the tragedy of the Titanic, your messages have always forced us to think outside the box. Your vision, beliefs, and parables are gifts that we are really lucky to have you be an influence in our lives. So I have a parable for you. There's a Japanese tradition of never filling your own cup, always filling that of someone else who would return the favor. This is how I think of you, always filling someone else's cup. I want to thank you for always filling our cup. Here's to you and Harvey, Steve. Congratulations on a job well done.
Get out in that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Get out in that kitchen and rattle those pots and pans. Well, roll my breakfast, 'cause I'm a